Okay, let's continue. We understand that h is 250 over r squared, so therefore it's 250 over 25, which therefore gives us 10 cm. So which means r equals to 5 cm and h equals to 10 cm will contribute to the minimum area. We do not need to find the second derivative because the question already stated very clearly that this is the minimum area that we are talking about. So we are actually concerned about this area of material to be used. So the second part B, find the cost of the material used to be the least. Again, we already know the dimensions of R right now from part A. R is 5 cm and H is 10 cm. Now you want to find the cost. People already tell you that the curved surface area is 0.5 cm. It's 5 cents and 3 cents for the base. 5 cents for the curved side. I believe question B, try it out with your partners right now, all right, and find the cost. All right, it's really a very simple a mathematical question that requires only sec 1 and sec 2 mathematical knowledge. So this one doesn't require any sophisticated knowledge that we learn from addition and max. So can you all look at this carefully and work out the answer and check the answers with your classmates? So I'll give you all about another 5 minutes to get the answer for this. Now let's go to question 15. Alright, question 15 is very, very interesting question because it actually combines what you have learned in quadratic roots to maximum and minimum values. So it states here, if alpha is a positive root, not negative, they emphasize the word positive, calculate the value of alpha for which P has a stationary value, and determine if this value is a maximum minimum. So when you look at this question, it's actually a very simple question. You just have to actually recall back your mathematical knowledge and concepts from quadratic expressions. So if you look here right now, it states here that 2x squared plus px plus 18 is equals to 0. So now, calculate the value of alpha for which p has a stationary value. But you'll be asking yourself, I do not even have an expression in terms of p and alpha. So this is where you need to formulate the expression out. Okay, now, if you look at this question, you will understand that alpha will be equals to, what do you think? Not forgetting, from our roots of equation, this would be minus p plus minus square root p square minus 4 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 18 over 2 multiply by 2. Why am I using this? But when I look at this expression, it gives me a real headache. Alright? Because of this. This is quite tedious. Is there any simplified way to do it? Is there any simplified method to do this? Maybe you like to discuss with your friends. Alright, if there is, please share it with us. If not, I will stick to this method right now. So right now, so let me simplify this expression. Alpha will be equals to minus p over 4. We want the positive root. Obviously, this one must then be the value positive. Alright, so we will get the square root p square minus, my apologies students, there is a mistake over here because silly me. Alright, let me redo this question again. And okay, for question 15 I make a mistake. Alright, sorry. Now we understand from this question that alpha is a root of 2x squared plus px plus 18 equals to 0. Am I right to say, therefore, 2 alpha squared plus p alpha plus 18 will be equals to 0? Because recall, when I say x equals to 3 is a root of x squared minus 9 equals to 0, then this implies when I substitute 3 in, the result should be 0. So this is in the same case right now. So I'm going to substitute alpha into my x, because I say that alpha is a root of this equation. Therefore, if I were to substitute alpha in into the expression 2x plus px plus 18, you should give me the value 0. So from here, if I look at this carefully, I'm going to get p in terms of alpha right now, because we want to find out values of alpha for which p is stationary. So p alpha is equals to minus 18 minus 2 alpha squared. So p is therefore equals to minus 18 over alpha minus 2 alpha, since they are the same denominator alpha. So right now we want to determine for which p has a stationary value. This means we need to know about the differentiate. We need to differentiate p with respect to alpha, and eventually equate the p over the alpha to be equals to 0. So in this case, I will have minus. Minus minus will become plus. I will get 18 over alpha squared. Alright? Minus 2. So when there are stationary points, for p stationary, to find the stationary value of p, the alpha will be equals to 0. So therefore, 18 over alpha squared minus 2 is equals to 0. 18 over alpha squared is equals to 2. And when we work this out, alpha squared will therefore be equals to 9. And when we square root it, we get plus 3 or negative 3, of which we will reject the negative 3. Why? Because alpha equals to plus 3 is a alpha is stated to be a positive root. So next, we have to determine whether this value of p is a maximum or a minimum. That means you have to determine the nature of the roots. So we have to do the second derivative. So the square p over the alpha square will be equals to minus 36 over alpha cubed. So for alpha to be equals to 3, we can clearly see d square p, d alpha square, will be smaller than 0. This implies, all right, p is a maximum for alpha equals to 3. Okay, I make a mistake over here because I always forget, and this is some common mistake that even students will always make. I have found alpha, but I've forgotten to find my p. Many times students, this is even I will make mistakes, everybody will make this mistake, so be careful. What will happen is that when you, after you find alpha, a lot of students forgotten and to really focus on the question. In this question, they want the value of p, all right? They want the value of alpha, so there's no mistakes. What I'm trying to say sometimes is that you have to be careful. When the question, sometimes what happens is that after you solve for alpha or solve for x, you have forgotten that sometimes they may want to ask you to find the maximum value of which therefore you do not, don't ever forget about this part over here, which means sometimes you may need to find the value of P. Alright? Now let us go on to the last question, question 17. Alright, so we have completed question 10, 12, 15. Now let us do 17. Alright? Now in the diagram, let's read the question. Take about 5 minutes to read the question again. 5 minutes to read the question. Relief teacher, I have the trouble you all to actually pause the video for a while. Okay, 5 minutes up. Okay, now I know some of you must be laughing. Okay, but let's focus back on the question, on the lessons again. Okay, in the diagram, a man, let's read the question. In the diagram, a man walks a distance of x meter at a speed of 1.25 meter per second from A to B. So let me draw in the diagram right now. So we have A to B. And the description given to us is that this distance over here is x, and he travels at a speed from A to B at 1.25 meter per second. So in other words, from rate of change, we understand that this is actually referring to dx, dt. If you can, you know, if you can actually see this, that's pretty good. All right. So now we're gonna form our beloved triangle, which is given to us in here. So we get something like this. All right. And this is AB. This is C, and this is D. Alright, so it's given to us that the whole length here is 20 meters. And the length from D to C is 10 meters. Alright, and additional information given to us was that he swim across a river directly from B to D at a speed of 1 meter per second. So I'm going to call this, I have no more other variables, but just leave it as it is first. And what they want us to show right now is that the time they're going to reach D is given by T is equals to square root 100 and up with 20 minus x to the power of 2 plus 4x over 5. So when we read the question again, we must understand what's the meaning of the time taken to reach D. So if we look at this carefully, what I basically understand from it is that we need to calculate the time that was taken to travel from A to B followed by B to D. Alright, so now let us think about how we're going to prove this. We understand that time is equals to distance over speed. Am I right to say that? Alright, we can actually separate this into two sections right now. One will be from A to B and the other one from B to D. So for section, for AB, clearly the time taken, TAB, let's differentiate, categorize them. TAB will be equals to x, which is the distance, over 1.25. Alright, so we leave it as it is first. And you make it a habit of not leaving your denominator as a decimal. 1.25 is actually 1 and a 1 over 4, which is actually 4x over 5. So now for the tedious part will be for section BD. Alright, for BD, we are given the speed, but we do not know what is the distance BD. But if you look at this carefully, we then see a right angle triangle BDC. How do I know? Because we can see that D is directly opposite to C. So we can be very sure that when we extend the line BD